Hey guys, it's your host Davion. Welcome to another episode of Conscious TV, baby. You know, we are rolling this commentary out. Honey, I released the first interview, okay, on Wednesday night. So I want you guys to check out the first interview. There is a conclusion or a perspective that I have, and there's a reason why we are telling the other side. So you guys will understand where this is going. So in this interview, you're going to hear from another witness who was in close proximity to not only the accuser, but to the accuser's wife as well. There seems to be a pattern as it relates to some character issues, some integrity issues. That's what you guys are hearing in these interviews. $10,000 of debt. $10,000 worth of debt was left to this victim of the accuser, okay? So you guys are going to hear his perspective. He also was connected to ministry at the time that the accuser was a part of the ministry, etc. And so just listen up, be present. If you guys are new here, definitely give me a old nasty piece of thumbs up, honey. And thank you all too for the cash apps and the donations and the encouragement. I mean, you guys are really, really, really freaking wonderful. I really appreciate you guys appreciating me. So shout out to all of my patrons. If you're not in the Patreon, you want to be in the Patreon. The receipts for this particular interview are going to be dropping in the Patreon. You're going to see that the victim here of the accuser spent a year. Or two, almost, chasing down the accuser and his partner for his coin. So, yeah, it's a lot going on. Also, there is a plethora of other content creators who also received the cease and desist. We will be coming back to talk about who received the cease and desist. But I'm going to be dropping also the letter that they received in the Patreon. So you guys make sure to head on over there as well. Like I said, all documentations, receipts, all of the legalities around the case are going to be in the Patreon. Okay, I love you all, and stay blessed, stay diligent, and most importantly, stay woke, stay lucid as hell. We in trying times, darling. Trying times. Oh, see you guys later.
I know a place where you can recharge your soul.
Baby, that's Conscious TV.
And in the midst of brokenness, he gon' see your asshole.
Baby, that's Conscious TV.
You gon' heal, you gon' laugh, and catch a little shade.
Ooh, girl.
Y'all know he be slaying, y'all better stop playing. Come hear what he's saying.
Ladies and gentlemen.
Hey, sir, how are you doing today?
I'm doing well, and yourself?
I am doing well. It's really nice out, and I really appreciate this weather. I appreciate you speaking to me, obviously. Unfortunately, you know, we're having to communicate under these circumstances, which are some very strenuous circumstances, considering the level of allegations that are being made against Dr. Larry Reed. From my understanding, I know that you have had a relationship to Dr. Larry Reed, and you've also had a relationship to the accuser. And so in this dialogue, I'm just going to get you to talk to us about the continuity of how you initially met Dr. Larry, your experience within the ministry, and then eventually how you came to know the accuser, and then the string of events that took place in terms of where things kind of went downhill at.
Yeah, I met Larry, it was probably back in 06. We were stationed, got stationed in at Fort Bragg, coming out of Georgia. And my wife knew his wife, and so that's how we connected and got involved with the ministry. And then, you know, we quickly transitioned from Fayetteville to Raleigh. So we weren't a part of the ministry long in Fayetteville before we transitioned to Raleigh. But man, Reed has always been a genuine person, man, a great mentor, a great friend. And he always wanted everybody that was a part of the ministry to reach their full potential and grow as an individual and get closer to God, right? And really make impact in the world. And he always pushed all of that, all of us to do that. Even seeing our call the way God showed him before we even seen it, you know. And, you know, I was just a member, and I kind of like, you know, graduated through the ministry by way of my growth spiritually, you know, from being a deacon, you know, and then becoming an ordained minister, an elder in the ministry. And that took time, you know, that took time, that took commitment. And he mentored me throughout that process, just like every other leader in the ministry, man, and provided the support and the spiritual guidance, both naturally and spiritually. I mean, even, you know, being a part of the ministry, you know, he always taught about, you know, finances, how to be responsible, and just how to be well-rounded as an individual holistically. And so I've always appreciated my relationship with Larry and the trust that he had in me as a leader in ministry, because, you know, Larry don't, you know, it's a handful of times that Larry would invite another pastor to preach at the church, but he would let me preach, you know, because he trusted mm-hmm. me, because he helped cultivate what was in me by way of the Spirit, you know, and mm-hmm. so he knew that. And so, man, that's been my relationship with Larry from day one up until mm-hmm. where we are right now. It never has changed. Even when, you know, he stepped outside the four walls of the church, my dynamic and my relationship with him hasn't changed, man.
That's and, nice.
It's been that way. And it's what it is, man.
Okay, that's dope. So how long was it from the time that you were in the ministry to the time that you came into contact with the accuser?
I would probably say probably a couple years, maybe like 3 years. You know, it was more so coming in contact with him when we got settled really in Raleigh. And I mean, I knew his mom. I think we were assigned to her when we first joined the ministry. She was like our care pastor. And so we used to go over and do some Bible study and stuff like that, if I recall correctly. And then, you know, we transitioned to Raleigh, you know, everything kind of changed. And so, you know, we lived in a whole nother area that wasn't in Raleigh. We wasn't even in the county. And so we would just drive up on Sunday and go to church and Wednesday night Bible study or whatever. And so when I came in contact with the accuser, he was a young man. You know, had aspirations to play the drums. He was a drummer in the ministry. Just watched him grow, cultivate his gift, and you know, he changed his life and became a part of the ministry. Was a good kid, very respectful. You know, and Larry was kind of like a father figure to him, the way I viewed it. And so, you know, that's what it was. Like I said, everybody, all the males in the ministry tried to mentor all the younger men that was in the ministry and support them on their journey. And so, you know, again, Larry cultivated everybody the same. Mm-hmm. And it was no different from the accuser, you know. You know, and so, you know, he was able to live with Larry and grow when he transitioned to Raleigh. I think his mom felt it was better for him to grow and develop. And so Larry invited him in, just like he did with his own nephews and mm-hmm. and his other team that lived with him. And so, you know, everybody was in an environment where they could grow and thrive and be successful.
And the last witness that I spoke to, he also had mentioned that his initial experience of the accuser was actually a really pleasant, that the accuser, you know, seemed like a really nice guy. Everything was really fine and okay before the issues came into play. How long was it after your contact and initial introduction to or with the accuser that you and the accuser begin to have any issues?
It was a couple of years. I don't know the exact years, but I do know when the issues seem to get toxic is when him and his wife got together.
So the accuser wasn't a teenager at this time. He was a grown man.
Yeah, he was a man when things got toxic.
Okay, got it. Okay.
Yeah.
Do you know about what age? Like early 20s?
Yeah, it was probably like early 20s.
Okay.
I would say early 20s. When him and his current wife got together and we found out that they were involved before they even got married. That's when things got toxic.
Okay.
You know, because elders in the ministry, you know, we try to coach around doing the right thing and focusing on your future. And so it didn't seem like that's the direction they wanted to go in as a couple. And so I think they ended up leaving the ministry behind all of that because they wanted to be together or whatever. And
just for clarity's sake, you are saying that his current wife was actually a woman within the congregation as well. I believe she was a prophetess, if I'm not
mistaken. Yeah, okay. She was a prophetess in ministry. She held a position in a functioning ministry before I did. Actually, I mean, she was a very prophetic individual as a prophet, had a dynamic gift, you know, and so, you know, yeah, she was in the ministry as well. Probably before he came, I would say.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
So, yeah. She was a, you know, you could consider her a leader in the ministry. And so when all of that happened, right, you know, as leaders, you know, we have to get an understanding and, you know,
yes,
the how, the what, the why, and to prevent spiritual damage to the entire body. And so that's what we were trying to do as leaders.
Okay.
But I don't think that's what they wanted. I think they desired to be together. And mm-hmm.
Was that against any of the ministry's rules, or was that something that wasn't permitted?
Well, I wouldn't say it wasn't permitted. However, you know, in any ministry, we want to focus on people growing, right? You know, and so I think there may have been some sneaking out of the house and you know, kind of doing it on the low, so to speak. And so, you know, we're just trying to have an understanding of all of that. Like, you know, if you had an interest in that way, let's do it right, if that's what you're interested in. So from a ministry standpoint, that's what we were looking at. Like, you know, is this something y'all really want to do? What's going on here? You know, why you sneaking around, so forth and so on. And that's what it boiled down to. And I just don't think that's what they were interested in. And as I recall, I remember they left and went to Greensboro, I want to say. And of course, we wouldn't want nobody to just be dating out of wedlock or whatever the case may be. We wanted to be done based on the way we interpret the scripture. And so I don't think that's what they wanted to do at the time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I can definitely understand you guys' concern, especially in the context of the church and spirituality. And everybody knows how messy relationships can be, especially when people are unclear. And so I can understand y'all wanting to help be a guiding post, because if they were just having sex or just kind of giving into impulses and then things would have went wrong, that could have brought a lot of drama into the ministry and between them two that would have, of course, bled out. So I totally get it. How close did you end up? So were you close to the now wife as well?
And so what ended up happening with myself and her, even before they got involved, is that she wanted to go to school and get her degree in cosmetology. And she approached me and my wife, you know, about possibly co-signing. And, you know, I went up to it in the beginning. You know, I just kind of tossed it around and, you know, talked to leadership about it. And so we ended up doing it on her behalf to support her dreams. And, you know, when they ended up leaving the ministry, it was approaching the time where it was time for the student loan to start to be paid for. And I had no way or means of contacting them. And I think when I finally did contact her, she was a little bit emotional and because, you know, what happened with the ministry and all of that. And so we had to start talking about payment arrangements. And so they ended up coming back to the ministry at some point. And, you know, the payment process went well in the beginning. But when after they got married, you know, me being a respectful person, I wanted to deal with him as the husband.
Absolutely.
You know, and not, you know, I don't want to, I would want somebody to do me like that. So I do on the others as I want done.
Amigo to amigo.
Yeah. So I started interacting with him about the payments because I'm attached to the profile and she's attached to it because I co-signed.
Right.
And so, you know, it got to a point where I was getting more calls from the collector, and it's like, man, this is starting to impact my credit, my psyche. You know, I got a family to raise. I don't need to be stressed about somebody else's situation, even though I co-signed, right? I didn't co-sign to pay it for you. I co-signed to give you a leg up.
Right.
And that's when, man, it went downhill, you know. It just became like a second job having to run them down about paying me my money, you know, saying I paid it, then I sit back and like, okay, you paid it, good. I ain't got a word. Then I get a call saying it's late, or a letter in the mail saying it's late when you done told me it's been paid. And man, that went on going back and forth, trying to run them down for probably a year or two. And then they just stopped responding altogether, man. And
so you were running them down for 2 years about this debt, and then they tried to disappear altogether.
Well, ain't no try to disappear.
Well, they disappeared altogether.
Disappeared altogether. And
wow. Okay.
Checks.
Oh.
You know, I paid a payment. Then I got to get them. Hey, man, when you going to give me my money back? You know, it was like I said, it was like a second job I had picked up to get my money back, if I got it back at all.
Wow.
If I got it, and you know, we ain't talking about no little change. I was paying average $180 a month, that's every month. And you know, sometimes I may get $100 back, sometimes I may get all of it back. Sometimes I may get none of it back, and I'm reaching out, being cordial. I wasn't disrespectful when I reached out. Just like, hey, man, you know, I know you can squirt on me and disappear, but like, why would you do me like that?
Yeah, because you also submitted a series of screenshots that I assume is from a social media website where you were attempting, obviously, to get in contact with them about this debt, and they were pretty unresponsive.
Yeah, it was from Messenger. Yeah, it was from Facebook Messenger. Yeah.
Facebook Messenger. Mm.
Yeah, and like I said, I was very respectful. Like, hey, you know, this what you said you was going to do. You said you were going to get it to me Friday. It's not Saturday or Monday. Like, just give me the payment. Be honest with me. Even if you can't pay it, just be honest. Nothing, man. Nothing. And the reason why I approach it like that, man, because I'm a man of integrity. I'm a man of faith. This man is younger than me. I wasn't finna disrespect him. Like it was a situation where I was trying to be the example and see if leading with love would at least show them like this man hadn't did us no harm. Why would we do
right?
That? You know what I'm saying?
Right. Yeah. Like all you was asking for is honesty and communication. Like if you guys can't pay it, I need to know that you can't pay it. I need to know what the real circumstance is, obviously, you know, like don't willingly lie to me. And you guys know that, you know, they're after their money and I've co-signed on, you know, wife's behalf, etc. So you were definitely asking for what they could have gave freely. They couldn't submit a payment, but they could have submitted the truth at least.
That's all I was asking for, you know.
That's all you were asking for.
Then when
and just to be clear to the audience, we're talking about a sum total of how much money that was owed?
Man, it was probably, when I paid it off, it was probably right at $8,000. But all the
I will throw this laptop out of the window.
Yeah.
They left you with an estimated of $8,000 in debt and student loan debt.
Yeah.
High and dry.
Yeah. Yeah.
Not $150, not $550, not $800, $8,000.
Yeah.
In student loan debt that you chose to in good faith and support for another woman in the ministry. And good conscience.
Yeah, good conscience.
Good conscience. And you were ignored, rejected, lied to, and ultimately dispose of?
All of the above, in that order.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah.
So
the payoff amount came after I had paid on it for quite some time with no response. So, you know, it probably totaled up to more than that. You know, that was just the payoff amount when I was just like, you know, I'm sick of it, because my spouse wanted to, you know, file a lawsuit, and I wanted to, you know, have a different conversation of sorts, and Larry was the one that told me to back off and leave it alone, and I told my wife the same thing.
So Larry has a habit of being very long suffering.
Yeah, Larry stopped that. You know, Larry messaged me after I reached out in the public on social media and was gonna take a different route, and he was like, "Don't do it, you know, don't do it," and it just reminded me of you know, just like, man, you know you rise above, man. Gotta get that back to you. That's how I seen it. And and I went ahead and paid it off, man, and told my wife to stand down and leave it alone, man.
Wow.
And you know, and we talking about facts, we talking about character, like a person's character, like, yes, what kind of human. Not one human, but we're talking about two people involved.
Two people. Mm-hmm.
Would sit around and know a man hadn't did nothing to you other than try to help you, and you would conduct yourself in this manner, you know.
Wow.
And you know how to get in touch with
him. Mm-hmm. Well, I was going to ask you too, like, what made Facebook Messenger the preferred method of conduct? I mean, a communication. Did they not have cell phones at the time, or?
No, they kind of seemed to be from pillar to post so much, man.
Mm-hmm.
You know, a number here, a number there.
Okay.
You know, and so seemed like they were always active on Facebook by some means. And so Messenger, you know, was the primary, mm-hmm, was the go-to.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, again, when they first got to Atlanta, it was some hardship going on. You know, kind of talked to them about that and gave them some grace, you know, and the accuser started gigging, quote unquote gigging, whatever that means, with his talent, but still no follow through, man. You know, tell me this, tell me that, give me the runaround, try to get a cosign release, but they wasn't working enough to get me off of that. And they said they submitted paperwork. I called the lender. They said they ain't never got it. So I said, you know, I'm tired, man. I don't want to deal with it.
Wow. I'm kind of speechless, especially considering that these are people who are claiming to be saved and a love for God and a heart for God and filled with the Holy Spirit, and this behavior is pretty atrocious. I know in our pre-interview you mentioned how you also witnessed Larry Reed be rather good to the accuser as well. I think you mentioned that Larry Reed had got him an apartment at one point in time, cars, leases, that Larry was this kind of person in general to really kind of go over and beyond to really help stabilize people.
Without a doubt, man. You know, Larry the type of guy, man, where, you know, that's the reason why he moved people in, to not see them experience hardship,
mm-hmm,
and have to worry about what they gonna eat, what roof over their head. Larry, if Larry went out to eat and five people was with him, Larry paid for five people food.
Yeah, and that's kind of surprising because Larry kind of cheap.
I mean, but see, Larry's about investing in people's life,
and
exposing them to lessons. So what I would take, and I would go out, he would do the same thing, and I had my own money. But what I would in turn do is, when I would go out with people, I would pay it forward because of seeing that example.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I still do it to, mm-hmm, this day. If I'm in the line at McDonald's, I'll pay for a car behind me, you know, just because. And he did that for the accuser, put him up in apartments so they wouldn't have to worry.
Got, well, I'm really glad you told me that.
What told, mm-hmm, you
that? You know, like how much of a provider that Larry is, because the next time that we do brunch, I'm gonna let him know that witness number two told me that tabs get paid for around these pods. So
yeah,
it's good to know. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So Have you seen the accuser or his wife after this whole ordeal with the student loan payments at all physically?
No.
No. Okay. Are y'all still connected in any kind of way?
I think he may have unfriended me on Facebook.
Okay.
And I think I'm still friends with his wife. But nah.
Okay.
I feel like he really going through something, man. And you know, as you know, on the phone, I ain't said not one thing negative about him.
No, you didn't.
Because I'm just talking facts.
Yeah.
This ain't me taking a jab.
Right.
This is real life.
Or even talking about your feelings, you're literally talking about what literally transpired.
I hadn't put 1 ounce of my feelings in it because it ain't about my feelings.
Right.
It's about what is going on with Buddy that he would conduct himself in this manner.
Wow.
And he still and he still know how to get in touch with me if he wanted to have a conversation about you know, why this one taken care of or that one taken care of. I mean, I hadn't hit myself.
So for you to be in a position you're in, you must find it pretty appalling that he could have the nerve to attempt to hold somebody else accountable when he's not even holding himself or his partner accountable for what they've done to you.
I'm baffled. That's shocking. Yeah. That's sad. That's shocking and that's sad.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You know, what if that would have put me in a jam and caused me to be homeless and caused my family not to eat?
Right. Right. And didn't seem to care either.
At all. I mean, I was hoping, you know how you sit around and like look out the window and hope. You know, I was hoping to get an email or something to just say, hey man, we noticed that you paid it off. When we get our act together one day, we'll try to make this right.
Now, you had mentioned something earlier when you said that you know, this person really looked up to Larry, and I know that the previous witness who also has had his own discrepancies with the accuser also stated that the accuser had a really uncanny admiration for Larry, like almost to the point of total imitation in terms of how he spoke, how he dressed, that he literally was trying to model himself after Larry. Did you witness that as well?
Yeah, and I think that came from, you know, wanting to stay connected, wanted to prove yourself, to stay connected, you know, even singing and, you know, dressing and, you know, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, looking at it at the time, like it was like, okay, yeah, okay, all right, that makes sense. That make a little bit of sense, you know. Yeah, okay. Mm-hmm. You know, it wasn't like you know, like, oh man, that's abnormal, because you know, people do that when they got a role model in their life, they tell you,
yes,
like, well, this is a basketball. Mm-hmm. You know, everybody want to be like Mike, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So it just turned weird when the access to Larry wasn't there no more.
Mm-hmm.
That's when it got weird, right?
Yeah.
It's like going up to get an autograph from your role model, and he said he finished signing the autograph. That make you feel some kind of way.
Yeah, because from my understanding, you know, after a series of drama played out in the church, obviously they played out between all of y'all. As you said, these allegations were made 2 years ago as well. And Larry was rather forgiving, from my understanding of the accuser. The accuser came back with a sob story and apologized and claimed that, you know, people were in his ear and wanting him to say that about Larry, etc. And Larry, being the long-suffering person he is, decided to let bygones be bygones and let things be civil. And then he had a dream that caused him to kind of, you know, realized that there was a poison within the milk. And so he separated himself. And then after that separation is kind of what launched these allegations all over again. I was going to state that, you know, I think ministry is very interesting because the church oftentimes likes to say that the church is a hospital. I think a lot of ministers, including Larry and all other young men coming up in ministry and women coming up in ministry, need to really be mindful of that, because you're stepping into a realm where you are choosing to attempt to love and provide family and a home to some really broken people. And I think a lot of times as believers, we're so optimistic and we're so about the work and the mission that we kind of forget that there's also a level of danger to being connected to people who are coming from a broken past, who've been abandoned, who have a plethora of different emotional and mental issues. And so this opens a lot of innocent people up to being preyed upon, to being used, to being slandered, and to going through things like what Larry Reed is going through. And I know that we're living in this age of Me Too and Raspy and Chris Stokes and R. Kelly and Harvey Weinstein and all of this, but we oftentimes don't talk about the other side of the coin, which is that there are people who also co-opt these movements about survivors as a way to get attention, and who perpetrate the fraud and who simply lie. I can think about the situation with Usher, where one of his accusers, I forgot the big girl name, but she had came out and claimed that Usher had brought her back to a hotel room and there was a sexual exchange and she had an STI. And then 2 weeks into the investigation and into her having an attorney, she came out and basically said she lied and that, you know, she just wanted 15 minutes. She was looking for attention. I can recall a particular witness in the Bill Cosby case, Janice Dickerson, ex-supermodel, who also came out and said that she practically completely embellished, you know, her allegations against Cosby. And so I don't want to negate that Black men in powerful positions, while they also can be the predator, they can also be the prey as well. Straight that up. People in power are attractive to disempowered people.
It's a fact. It's a fact. You know, in the power of social media and for anybody to gain relevance, it really makes anybody accessible, whether the person has access or not, because of the power of social media. So, that's where we are.
What do you encourage people to do who are kind of all over these allegations, who are thinking that there's truth here? Obviously I've done commentary and expressed things that make no sense to me, but I find it interesting that when things play out in the public opinion, that the public can require very little to jump on bandwagons. Like, this person is literally an avatar at this point. The accuser is an avatar. The accuser has not come forward in the light with their government name or even with their physical self. They're representing themselves as an avatar at this point. And people are acting like a testimony is, or an allegation is, anything other than an allegation.
Right.
And so it's kind of shocking, you know, because I've watched this type of stuff happen to celebrities. I know T.I. and Tiny going through their share of stuff. But when it happens this close to home, obviously you're connected to Larry, I'm connected to Larry, and so this is close to home. And to see this happening to somebody, you know, that I know personally, it's really wild to me. It makes me distrust the public. It makes me distrust, because the public oftentimes uses a lot of emotionalism to shape their perception of what's happening. And I'm just like, do you guys realize you guys don't know the accuser? You don't even know the first or last name of the accuser. You wouldn't even be able to pick the accuser out in a million man march. And you guys are, for whatever reason, very interested with running with these allegations. I mean, I would have no problem with people running with the allegations once they've been substantiated. Right. But these are just literally allegations, and you guys don't know this person from a can of paint on the wall. And it's bizarre. It's bizarre to me.
Well, what you got to consider is that people are fascinated by theatrics and drama
You're right. It's almost like social media that we're talking about. You're correct.
Yeah, it's almost like, man, I got the seat at the table, but also the imagination is a playground for fun, and it's also a cesspool at the same time. So a lot of times people will hate somebody and wait on moments like this to fuel a flame that ain't even lit. And so the people that are jumping on a bandwagon with no substance are people that have been waiting, that been sitting around saying, man, I know it's something about that person. It's got to be signed. You know, and so when the opportunity come up, you know, it's the ludicrous crowd that jump behind stuff that doesn't have any substance behind it. You know, that's why we got police stations and lawyers and things of that nature. You know, if you feel like you've been violated or something like that, you know, you go down and talk to the police about stuff like that.
So you think that people should be side-eyed when they run to social media rather than running to systems that can provide more thorough aid in terms of truth and justice?
With a sensitive matter like you alleging, I would want that to be as private and dealt with like I would a baby. And I wouldn't put an infant out there in a situation like that. That's delicate. If you say it, if that's what you alleging, I wouldn't. Like you doing it backwards. You like putting the cart before the horse or something. Like that's insane. Why would I come to somebody that's not trained, probably don't even have education,
and already has a bias toward the person?
I wouldn't know, man. That's like me. You know, I know the everything is changing with, you know, how we get information and things of that nature, but like, I don't go to social media to see what the weather is. I tend to watch the credible news sites to see what the weather's going to be. And so that's just how I live my life. But some people, they like to live off of some kind of like high and experience, like they get adrenaline rush, like a ride at a theme park. I don't live my life like that. I live in reality and I live in facts. And so, I mean, you know, you seem like a real nice guy. But I can't tell you that I'd be on social media watching your show. I just, you know.
That's, well, like, I know that after this, you better be a dedicated subscriber and fan, you know, sure.
That's just, you know, that's just who I am, man. How I live my life, man. I really try to, I try to stand tall, man, and be straight up, man. And I don't deal with a lot of this and a lot of that. It just don't make sense to me. Man, Larry get on his own platform and tell you the is and the isn'ts about himself. You know what I mean? So it's like, you know, that be like, man, you ain't had to say that, man. That's what we say, like, come on, what are you know? But that's the way he lived his life, man. And
A very authentic.
Yeah, he is, man. Yeah.
And sometimes to a fault, because sometimes I have to call him and be like, okay, you trying it. You're trying. Like, you need to like I understand openness, but I mean, come on now, you know how it gets.
Yeah, exactly. So no, man, that's not the way he coached us and trained us. So no.
But I guess that really does eventually really come around full circle, especially when it comes to stuff like this, where it's like, this is why a person would have a lot of credibility, is because they have the capacity to really be honest about things that other people would probably be too ashamed or embarrassed to even articulate publicly. And so, what, you know, the accuser obviously more than likely is going to listen to this interview. What would you want to say to him?
Man, I would say, call me ASAP. Call me, man. You know how to get in touch with me. You can hit me on Messenger, you know, and I'll pick the phone up, you know, and let's have a conversation of to right the wrong you done to me, because it was a wrong, and I ain't no love lost, ain't no hate, you know, ain't no hate, man. I done moved on, man. You know, I done moved on. You know, but make that right. You know, make that right.
Wow.
You know, make that right. How you what your conscience at that you lay down every day knowing you did somebody like that and you can go to sleep at night? You know, what did I do to you?
I can tell that y'all are really good people. A continuity that I have witnessed intuitively between you and the first witness is that the both of you have spoken in a way that's not slanderous, have only spoke y'all experience, with there still being an air of compassion and almost like openness there. And that's something that I don't find a lot of, especially when people have been violated in the ways that you two have been violated by this person.
When you let the Holy Spirit, not the religious spirit, the Holy Spirit, have access to your life and lead you and guide you, the Holy Spirit will tell you what's right and what you need to do and what you don't need to do. Opposite of what you feel, because we have feelings, right?
Yes.
But then there's also the ghost, the Holy Ghost, that also tells you what to do from a God consciousness and a God standard. And that's the standard I live by. And that's what keeps me. That's what has me in the place to be able to look at it the way I look at it, and deal with it the way I deal with it. I never unfriended them on social media. I ain't took no action that would bring them harm in any kind of way.
Nothing.
And that's you said that's what being saved looks like, but you know, let's even change the narrative on that. That's what being filled with the real Holy Ghost.
Pay this man for money. Pay this man for his money.
You a wise man.
And look, we're fighting on hard times, but you know, there's a few strip joints. That's a little higher. I mean, hey, honest living is honest living. So get this man's money. I really want to appreciate you, and I thank you for coming forward. Is there anything else that you want to communicate before we wrap?
That's it, man. God bless the world, man. We got too much work to be doing to be going back and forth like this. Too much work to be done. Everybody watching TV, we know what we got to be doing. Let's do that.
Absolutely. Well, I thank you so much for your time. I thank you so much for your participation. I think that your input and perspective was really valuable. We've only been hearing from one side of this, we've only been hearing from one party, so I thought it was only fair to hear from this side of the party in order to create a full balance view as much as possible to what's going on. So thank you so much. You're going to get everything that you've done back. Everything that you sold is going to come back to you 10 times fold, for sure. So you'll get the money back.
I receive that.
All right. Well, you stay right there, and I'm going to end this broadcast. You just played me for the last time. I'm done fucking with you. Keep coming with the same lines. Everything but the truth. You picked the wrong one, yeah, yeah. You picked the wrong one, baby. You just played me for the last time. I'm done fucking. Fucking with you.